Good morning, everyone. A very good morning to you all on this very special and sacred day. My prayer is that may God bless me and bless you as we seek to worship Him and endeavor to understand what actually took place on that special particular day. Good Friday is one of the greatest day in the history of the world, and it's the day which shaped up not only the earthly, but the heavenly realms as well. And it's the day that had people, the terrestrial and the celestial, both in wonder and amazement that what has been happening on this planet Earth. The Son of God looking down on the earth. The angels are even awe and wonder what is happening down on earth. Son of man, Son of God, being mistreated, tortured, and even to the point of death. Glory to God and to His Son, Jesus Christ, who bore it to the end, and even to the point of death. So me and you could be set free and be sat here rejoicing and glorifying His holy name. May I request Brian to please lead us in the opening prayer.
Shall we join in prayer together? Father, we just thank you for this time that we're going to spend in this place just remembering you. We won't have any idea as to what suffering you went through on our behalf on that Good Friday 2,000 years ago. We won't be able to imagine the suffering that you went through, the hurt that you went through, the way that you were treated. It's not even heavy enough on our hearts to fully understand the price has been paid that we may have eternal life. For that area of our life that we would call redemption. Lord, we just praise you for that. I know Rabbi Rakib will lead us to a point where we will consider that suffering on the cross in what he preaches, because that's the gospel. And men must need to understand that you went to the cross for each one of us here. Each single person, it wasn't a collective thing. If I'd been the only person that was ever saved, you would still have gone to the cross for me. And that's your individual way that you behave with us. So Lord, as we gather together, as we consider this Good Friday, and it would almost seem for us to question why we call it Good Friday, because it's only good for us. It wasn't good for you. You're a loving God and you're a great Father, and we have a great Saviour. And we just pray, Lord, that as we come together here for this short time, for it will only be a short time on this Good Friday, that when we go away from here, we might remember what we've heard, what we've seen, what we've taken part in. And we pray, Lord, that our hearts will be as they should be before you. For it's so easy, Lord, to have things on our lips that don't mean anything in our heart. And my heart believes, Lord, of the love of you. But I understand also that you love me beyond my understanding. We praise you and worship you, Lord. And all the people said, Amen.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you so much. We'll have our first hymn. It's God So Loved the World. And Gail kindly sent me that. Appreciate that. Thank you very much. And we'll stand to sing that song. Next one, if that's
just do something else, I'm just not getting any sound out.
Okay, that's fine.
As soon as you hear sound, stop.
All right, that's fine. Okay, just to set the stage a little bit, It is a day of joy, it's a day of victory, we understand that. But just particularly being focused on the Good Friday, there are certain things that I would be saying that might be upsetting to some disturbing realities. But I think we must know them. It's not an optional thing. We ought to know the realities, the gruesomeness, the brutality, and all that Jesus went through. Sometimes I hear people, it's so barbaric, it's so cruel, it might have psychological impact and all that. I understand to some extent, but even then, we need to know this, that what Savior went through for us, what he really underwent. To some degree, maybe we will never be able to fully understand or grasp the magnitude and the reality of what our Savior suffered. But still, I think it's very, very important to understand and to at least reflect or have a glimpse or have an idea of what Jesus really went through. I just want to give you a brief overview or an introduction of the importance of this day. We, like Brian said in the prayer, today is the Good Friday, and also known as the Holy Friday, which is the Friday we understand just before the Easter Sunday. Now, according to Oxford Dictionary, the word good could also mean holy. It could refer to as holy as used by the churches, even though it's fallen out of its use now, but it's Holy Friday as well. If you go back to the first Good Friday, after a series of trials and tribulations and interrogations by the Jewish and the Roman authorities, now Jesus was sentenced to death. I'm just taking you back 2,000 years ago, just for you to understand, you know that, but just to refresh our memories, what exactly in a nutshell happened on that day. Now Jesus was sentenced to death by a crucifixion, a common Roman punishment. Aware of the innocence, The Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, offered the crowd a choice of releasing Jesus or Barabbas, a savior or a thug, a God-man or a murderer. Now they chose murderer, Barabbas. Pilate ceremonially washed his hand to assert his innocence of Jesus' death. He had Jesus flogged, though, in itself a brutal punishment that frequently led to the death of those who suffered it, and led to the crucifixion. In keeping with the custom, Jesus was to carry his own cross to the place of execution. Exhausted and in pain, he fell under the burden, and the Romans caught and forced a bystander by the name of Simon the Cyrene to carry it for him. Jesus was crucified between two thieves, one of whom cursed him, while the other said, "Jesus, remember me when you come in your kingdom, into your kingdom." And a sign over his head said, "This is the King of the Jews." He died after 6 hours of pain, a relatively short time when victims could linger for days. The authorities were anxious to conclude the business because of the Sabbath began. Now they broke the legs of the two thieves to hasten their end, to speed up their death. However, Jesus was already dead. But a soldier stabbed him in the heart, in the side, to make sure, to ascertain that he's dead. When the bodies were broken down or taken down, in contrast to the usual fate of the crucified bodies, which were thrown into the lime pits, Jesus was laid into a tomb from the Joseph of Arimathea. The tumultuous, chaotic Good Friday was finally over. Wow. If you're just trying to grasp what I've just described to you, just then, other than thinking of it as a narrative, if you're trying to put yourself in that position, you would perhaps begin to understand what happened. The Son of God died that day so that you and I could live forever. Hallelujah. Can we say it a bit louder? Hallelujah. He died so me and you could live forever. We understand what Jews, like Brian implied in his prayer, we understand that what Jews and authorities and Romans did to Jesus was not good. It was gruesome. It was brutal. It was cruel. However, the results of Jesus' death are exceptionally good. Romans 5:8 tells us, "For God demonstrated his own love for us in us while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." 1 Peter 3:18 tells us, "For Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive by the Spirit." Look at the cross. for a while and see what happened on that day, on that cross. We'll pray back. We'll just skip this one, Robert. We'll have the next one after. Okay, that's fine. Just look at the cross of Christ for a moment and see what happened on that cross on that day. It is not enough to say that Jesus died. We hear that often, that Jesus died. But I think it is not enough to say that Jesus died because all men die. It is not enough to say that Jesus died a noble death because martyrs die a noble death. The truth of the matter is, Jesus died bearing our transgressions and bearing our iniquities for his people. He suffered a substitutionary death. The penalty of our sin was laid upon him, and so he died. Because nobody else died that way. That's what makes the death of Christ remarkably distinctive and remarkably different. He was forsaken by God and crushed under the wrath of his own Father for our sins. That's what makes the death of Christ distinctively remarkable. It's not he just died. And it's not that just he died a noble death. He died a substitutionary death. Spurgeon once said that my entire theology can be condensed into four words: Jesus died for me. He said the entirety, the totality of theology could be summed up and condensed in four words: Jesus died for me. The cross was a symbol of shame, disgrace, public disgrace, pain, and death for criminals. In fact, it was prepared for the hardened criminals. Jesus, who was without sin, who knew no sin, was made sin. Who knew no sin, who never sinned, was made sin and was crucified on the cross in Golgotha. Remember, Jesus' blood and suffering was greater, much, much, much more greater than the worldly significance of the cross in those days. Something happened to the cross when Jesus nailed on that cross. Something, subtle transformation took place when the body of Christ, when the body of the Son of God was hung on that cross. What transformation took place? What happened to the cross? There are many people died on the cross before. It was a common method of execution. So what is particularly special or different when Jesus died on the cross? Crucifixion was not uncommon. It was a common practice. But what happened to the cross and what transformation took place when Jesus hung or died on that cross? Listen to that. The shame and the humiliation of the cross turned into glory and splendor and majesty when Christ died on the cross. The cross, from being an instrument of death, became an instrument of eternal life. The cross, from being an instrument of disgrace, became a place of blessing and grace. And more grace, and more grace, and more grace, and more grace. Remember, grace is absolutely free, but it is not cheap. Grace is not cheap. It's costly. It cost the Son of God his life. He shed his blood on that cross. It cost him his life. That is why the grace we have as Christians, or for all those God showers his grace, is free, is absolutely free, but it is not cheap. It is not cheap. The Son of God trickled his blood, shed his blood, poured out his blood on that cross under the full wrath of his Father. The cross transformed from being a place of judgment to the place of mercy and forgiveness. The cross changed from humiliation to exaltation because Christ died on that cross. The cross, from being a curse, became a blessing. From the cross of Christ flows mercy and grace and love and acceptance and restoration and reconciliation and forgiveness. No one in hell could ever say. I was talking to a friend of mine who comes from a non-Christian background, and he said, it's not our fault if we are born this way or if we are born that way. I said, you're right. That's why Jesus said you must be born again. That's why he said you must be. We hear people say, I'm just born that way. That's why Jesus said, you must be born again. He understands that. He knows that. And I said to him, no one in hell would ever say that I went to Jesus and he rejected me. No one in hell would ever say that I called unto him, I cried unto him, I pleaded, I begged, and he despised me. No one. He never cast away anyone. He is God who accepts and forgives the same way he did to the thief. No one can say that. No one in eternity would be able to dare to say the word, I went to Jesus and he rejected me. And it applies to you and to me and to everyone who would ever hear my voice through this tape, that no one would ever say that I went to Christ and he rejected me. If you reject Christ today, if any one of you amongst here who is still not a believer, who is just nominal in his understanding, or he just understands and he knows that there is a guy called Jesus and have no saving relationship with him, I've got something, a news for you. If you reject Jesus today, you are in deep trouble. You are in serious danger. And I'm not trying to make it sound dramatic or thrilling or sensational. I'm saying it because it is true. And I'm saying it because I know and I mean what I say when I say. You cannot afford to die without Jesus Christ. You cannot. You just cannot shut your eyes here and expect to be treated well when you open wherever you would open. Let me share with you what I read the other day, an interesting acronym for the word cross. C, complete. R, redemption. O, offers. S, salvation. And S, security. Complete redemption offers salvation and security of eternal life for people who come to Christ. We are the recipients of the blessings and the benefits of the cross of Christ. We are the beneficiaries of the cross of Christ. Only Jesus satisfied justice. Only Jesus diverted wrath. Only Jesus conquered death. Only Jesus defeated death. And only Jesus opened heaven. Only Christ. Only Christ and only Christ. This is our confession, that Christ died for our sins, bearing our sins upon himself, and it is the blood of Jesus Christ that gives us the right standing before God. The sinners are declared saints, the unrighteous righteous, and the wicked upright. Do you understand that? Do you understand? Sinner declared saints. Even angels struggle to comprehend that. How could a man like me be declared righteous? But when you look at the cross, you see how it is not possible for a man, a sinner, to be declared saint when the Son of Man bore his or her sins. Hebrews 4:14 tells us that let's hold firmly to the faith we profess. Let's hold firmly, hold fast to the confession we make. Spurgeon once said again, hold everything earthly with a loose hand, but grasp eternal things with a death-like grip. Eternal things ought to be held with a death-like grip. You don't hold on to Christ as if it doesn't matter if he lets go of you or you let go, but whichever way it works, even though we understand that he never lets go of us, we try to do a lot the opposite to that. But Spurgeon suggests, he admonishes church, grip things with a death-like grip. And that's Hebrew writer said as well. Hold fast, hold firm. Don't let go of that, of your confession. Don't be a part-time Christian when God is not a part-time Savior. Jesus said he will die, and so he did. Jesus said he will rise again, and so he did. Jesus said he will come again, and he will. And he surely will. Get ready, get ready, get ready. If Jesus Christ returns right now, would you be found in faith? Are you saved? Are you saved? That is the question of all the question. The ultimate question of all the question is this. Are you saved? If Christ returns today, if he makes his way right now, would you be found in faith? Or would you still be in darkness? Do you know that everything you have done in life, everything you have achieved in life, everything you have understood in life, everything you know in life will be left here and be no use to you when it has come out of the fire that it is going to be shoved into? And only one thing will come out of the fire, intact, pure, refined, and whole, and that is your faith in Lord Jesus Christ. That is the only thing that is going to stay with us forever. Revelation 22:14 tells us, blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may go through the gates into the city. Are your robes clean? Are your robes washed with the blood of Jesus Christ? Because if they're not, you must be afraid. You must be very afraid. I have this reputation of sometimes being so scaremongering kind of situation. But that is true. You must be scared. I can't stand here and say you're fine just because you showed up in the church, you're okay. No, you're not. You can sleep in the garage and will still not become a car. You can come to the church and still go unsaved. The question is still, are you saved? Are your robes washed? Has Jesus cleansed you? Have you been purified by the blood of Jesus Christ? Because God not only saves us, he will keep us saved. If he has saved you once upon a time, you hear people say, I was saved 3 years ago or 5 or 10 years ago. And when you look at their life, not being judgmental, but when you look at their life, you evaluate them, you see that there is no characteristics of their Father God whom they profess to belong to. If Jesus once saved you, he will keep you saved. Yes. He who began a good work will finish it. Why? Because his reputation is on the line. His reputation is on the line. That he was mighty to save you once, but he couldn't keep you safe. And he is not going to fail. He is not going to fail. If he has saved you 3 years ago, he'll keep you safe. Check yourself, brethren. Examine yourself, Paul says. Examine yourself. Put yourself to the test and see if you're found in faith. People sometimes see you're almost trying to people doubt their salvation. That is not doubting your salvation. You're going to take issues with Paul because he said it, not with me. He said, examine your. He was talking to the church. Examine yourself, brethren. Are you in faith or are you not in faith? G.I. Packer once said, the idea that everyone, all are children of God is not found in the Bible, he says. And he's right. You must be accepted and adopted. That's why we have the doctrine of adoption. Doctrine of adoption into God's family. You must be born again. And God is absolutely sovereign in saving you. He's mighty to save you. He's desirous to save you. And he is able to save you. It's not that he desires to save you. He's able to save you. There are two different things. You might be desirous to do something, but you may not be able to do it. I desire to fly, but I may not be able to fly. He desires to save you, and he is able to save you. That's what makes the difference. He is able and he's mighty to save you. Arthur Pinks once said, the sovereignty of God may be defined as the exercise of his supremacy, being infinitely elevated above the highest creature. He said he is the most high, Arthur Pinks said, Lord of heaven and earth, subject to none, influenced by none. He's absolutely independent. God does as he pleases, and he does only as he pleases, and he always does what he pleases, and no one can thwart him, and no one can hinder him. He is sovereign in the work of salvation. Come to God through his Son, Jesus Christ. Throw yourself upon Christ. Sit at his doorstep. Wait upon him. Crawl to his feet. Lie before him, helpless and hopeless and friendless and powerless. Fall before him, and he will shine his face upon you. Cry out to him, and he will deliver you from your misery. He will redeem you from your sin. He will set you free from your lostness and your wretchedness. No one can thwart him. No one can stop him. No one can hinder him. If he wants to save you, he will save you. You knock at his door. You cry out to him. Don't just sit here and listen to me and try and digest it and forget all about it when you go back home, but try and understand that you must crawl to his feet. You must come to him and lie before him, hopeless and powerless and begging that he would have mercy on you. Because if he has no mercy on you, believe you me, you will have no mercy nowhere. If he does not take pity on you, you are the most pitiable person. If he has no pity on you, repent, repent, and repent. For the king is on his way. Thomas Watson, an English Puritan, once said, the first sermon that Jesus ever preached, in fact, the first word of his first sermon that he ever preached was what? Repent. That's what the first word Jesus ever uttered. Repent. He is coming back soon. Revelation 22, 12 says, behold, I'm coming soon, and my reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what they have done. No matter how far you have walked away, it's only a turnaround. The turnaround is always is one step. No matter how far you have walked away from God, the return trip is only one step. You just have to turn around and he will embrace you because he said so. And he does not lie.
Amen.
It's not the perfection of your life. It's the direction of your life. It's not how perfect you are, it's where you're heading. That's the question. I'm not trying to make myself or make you perfect. I'm not, because we will not until we see him. But the direction, where is the direction of your life? Where are you heading? Where are your children heading? Where are you heading? Where are your families heading? Where are the extended family, the brother, the sister, the sibling, the relative, the church, and everybody? Where is the direction of your life? That's the question of all questions. If you say, I'm so busy with this and that, I've got loads going on in my life, I'm so tied up with the things, then unbusy yourself. Disentangle yourself with whatever. Jesus said, cut them off, whatever stops you. Whatever it is, unbusy yourself, for heaven's sake, from all the entanglements that gets in the way. Put God first. He must be first. If he's not first, he's nowhere. He don't want to be second. If God is not first, he's nowhere. If God is not the king of your house, the king of your life, he is nothing. He ought to be there or he's nowhere. He does not share his glory. He's a jealous God. He shares his glory with none. Christians don't follow their hearts, their gut instincts. That's nonsense. They follow the word of God and they follow what Christ commands them, whether it makes sense to them or it doesn't make sense to them. You just do that. Jeremiah, Proverbs, Ezekiel, they're full of it. Loads and loads of verses there that backs me up on that. Break loose from all those entanglements and prioritize God. Time is nigh, brethren. This might be, I remember, because I had the recording of last Friday when I preached, I remember seeing some faces that I do not see now. Trust me. It could be a different story the next Good Friday. And you probably understand what I'm implying. There were some people in the last Good Friday that I do not see now. Mark my words, time is ticking. Clock is ticking. And be very scared. If Christ is not on your side, you have every reason to be scared. If God is not sovereign in your life, you have every reason to be worried. You have every reason to be afraid. You have every reason to be scared. Do not live in this illusion, I'll be fine. You will not be fine if God is not on your side. Is God really on your side? That's the question of all the questions, the ultimate questions. All right, let me relax you a little bit. And we'll have our hymn 2, Here I Am to Worship. If we...
Now stand, so that hymn, so we'll sing the hymn.
Okay, please.
506.
Thank you.
Sayings of our Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, also called the seven words of Jesus Christ on the cross. The first word is from the Gospel of Luke chapter 23 and 34. If I may request Robert to lead us in that scripture reading, please.
And Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they cast lots to divide his garments.
Thank you very much. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Jesus said these words between 9 and 12 on the first Good Friday. Now there are zillions and zillions and zillions and incalculable attributes and things that amazes me and perhaps amazes you about God. But what amazes me right here and what makes me marvel when Robert read this is the attribute of the patience of God, his endurance, his forbearance for sinners. Listen to what Romans 10:21 says concerning Israel. "All day long I have held out my hand," God says, "to a disobedient and an obstinate people." All day long, God has held out his hand. What amazes me here, the most amazing attribute of all the attributes, is the patience of God, his endurance of God. God is remarkably patient. He's incredibly merciful and exceptionally forgiving and compassionate. I sometimes wonder, how could God put up with some people? And then I look at myself and realize exactly the same way he puts up with me. God is incredibly patient. Sometimes we look at television and see all these people blowing up and doing all these nasty things, and we wonder, how could God put up with these people? And when you look at yourself, you say, that's how he puts up, because he's been putting up with me for too long. He is patient. He is a forgiving God. God's judgment should have come down right away. And it did, to be fair, but not on mobs or people, but on his son, Jesus Christ. Kevin D. Young once said, "It is not convincing to say that you're a child of God if you have none of the characteristics of your father." He said, "You do not convince me if you say you're a child of God if you do not have any attributes of your father, God." Are you a forgiving person? Do you forgive easily, or do you hold grudges? What you forgive people is absolutely nothing compared to what God has forgiven you. Isaiah 53:12 tells us centuries before that Jesus would make intercession for the transgressors. He would make intercession for the transgressors. That's remarkable. Making intercession for the transgressors. Yeah, I've heard people making intercession for the nice ones, good ones, lovely, decent, respectable, and all that, but making intercession for the transgressors. That's amazing. What it means is simply this: he thought of his murderer even when they were killing him. He pleaded for his crucifiers. He made intercessions for their forgiveness. Even when he is on the cross, he is talking, he is speaking, he is uttering forgiveness for the people who are doing exactly the nasty thing. The terrible, the dreadful, the gruesome reality that is going on and portrayed in front of him and to him. Jesus is praying forgiveness for them. Forgiveness is God's gift made available to us through Jesus Christ. Are you a forgiving person or do you hold grudges? If you say you're a child of God, show your characteristic. Yes, I will say show it. You need to display it. It needs to be on public display. This is a child of God. Look at his life. It's an open book. Everyone can see through it. There is no mystery going on there. God's attribute will be seen in your life. Second word on the cross that Jesus spoke from the cross is from Luke 23 and 43. And I've requested Val to please read that for us. Luke 23:43.
And he said to him, "Truly I say unto you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you so much. I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. What an amazing display of love, grace, mercy, and forgiveness. One thief received him and one rejected him. One recognized his sinfulness and demanded nothing but what? A humble plea. Remember me. He didn't ask much. He said, remember me. And Jesus, even though in his pain and agony, he was ready to receive him. Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Even in the deathbed confession of that thief, Jesus Christ accepted him. Christ is able to save all who come to him. Even in their deathbed confession, Christ would accept them. All who come to him. God's grace exceeds our expectation. God's grace works beyond our wildest imagination. God's grace is inconceivable. It is like a mighty river that never runs dry. It's off the charts. God's grace is off the charts. The saddest day in the life of that thief became the happiest day of his life because Jesus was there. Let me stress on these two words for a second. What two words do you think I would have been thinking of? Two words. Remember me. Believe you me, everyone, when Jesus comes back in his kingdom, would want him to remember that, don't you? When he returns as a king, you want him to remember you. And that's what he said, remember me. He remembers all those who belong to him. But there's a good news is, he remembers all those who belong to him. He knows his sheep. He never forgets his own people. The word of God says he knows them by their names. Exodus 33:17, God said, I know you by name, Moses. And John tells us Jesus knows and calls his sheep by name. Jesus knows us by name. He said, remember me. If Christ returns today, you want him to remember you. Two more important words, with me. Jesus could have simply said, today you will be in paradise. But the words are, you will be in paradise with me. That reveals that he wants to be with his people. He desires to be with his people. He said he will never leave us nor forsake us. He said, won't leave you like orphans. Matthew 28 said, I'm always with you even to the end of the age. And then Revelation 21:3 says, behold the tabernacle. Listen to this verse, beautiful words. In the second last chapter of the New Testament, behold the tabernacle of God is with men and he will dwell with them and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. Jesus could have said, today you will be in paradise. But he said, you will be in paradise with me. He dwells with his people. He lives with his people. The tabernacle that comes down, he said, he will be with his people. As a matter of fact, the paradise will be a hell, a torturous hell, if Jesus is not there anyway. The beauty of paradise is not silver, gold, milk, honey, or anything, but Jesus Christ being there. If the Lamb of God is not there, it's hell. Paradise will become hell. What he said to the thief, he says this to us today. He will remember us. And he will be in paradise with us if we fall upon Christ like that repentant, penitent thief. Third word from Gospel of John chapter 19, verse 26 to 27. Peter, please.
When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own house.
Thank you very much. Dear woman, here is your son. It's a word of affection, the word of relationship. Here is your mother. She is seeing her dying son. And she is the dying son's mother. Mary has been through some incredible stuff. We understand that. Yes, we respect Mary. Yes, we revere her. She is Jesus Christ, Mary the mother. We see that. We understand. We believe that. Of course, we don't worship her because she is human, just like any other human. But she is to be respected and honored because she is. The scripture tells us so. The angel Gabriel caused her some worry by making that announcement to her. Her virgin pregnancy was questioned to her reputation. There was no room in the inn to give birth to her son. Herod threatened her life and the long flight to Egypt, and she saw her son rejected and despised all her life. So she's been through some incredible stuff in her life. Now she has the greatest privilege of being Jesus' mother, but with greatest privilege comes greatest sorrows. The brow she kissed is thorn scar. The hands she held are pierced. The feet she taught to walk are now attached to the cross. The child she saw coming to the world, now she is watching him die. No words are recorded. No words are recorded from Mary because she watched in silence. She watched all that in silence. Here Christ comes to seek and comfort his troubled mother. He said Jesus was engaged in the most important redemptive work of the history of the histories, yet he fulfills his human obligations. Church work is never an excuse to abandon your family responsibilities. If Jesus could provide for the needs in the weakest or the deepest humiliating moments of his life, imagine how much he can provide for your needs in his exalted and glorified state. Right when he's dying and being crucified, he thinks of his mother and he takes care of us. What he could really do for us when he's in a glorified, exalted, most high place right now, not in humiliation, but in glory and splendor. Hope we understand this. Fourth saying is from Matthew 27 and verse 46. And Michael, would you please read that for us?
At about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," that is, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?"
Thank you very much. Elohi, Elohi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? This word is probably Jesus' lowest point, as well as the theologically highest point of his crucifixion. The Messiah himself is aware that God has forsaken him and has turned a deaf ear to his cry. This is not a symbolic or poetic forsakenness, it's real. It's real. If ever a person felt the forsakenness of God, it was Jesus, the Son of God, on the cross of Calvary. This is a fulfillment of Psalm 22:1, where Jesus expressing the abandonment as he lays down the sins, as the sins of the world are laid down upon him. God turns away from Jesus, and Jesus experiences a separation from God, the only time in all of the eternity. Now, Luke 23 and 44, 45 says, "Now it was about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun stopped shining." Now, this darkness was not a dim darkness. It was palpable. It was evident. It was clear. And it could be felt. Some theologians go further to say it was the darkness that could be felt. And where do they get this idea from? They're reminiscent of the darkness over the land of Egypt in the ninth plague. And Exodus 10, 21, 22 says, darkness was so intense that it could be felt. And that was the kind of darkness that was there. It is noteworthy that it is only here Jesus says, my God, because he is there as a supplicant, making request, why have you forsaken me? But that does not represent loss of faith. The fact is he's praying shows that he still trusts God, that he still trusts God. The contact has been lost, but he no longer feels Father's presence. He's separated. He's abandoned. Jesus is forsaken by God because he has taken our sins upon himself. He's atoning for the sins. John the Baptist said, "Look at the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Fifth, the saying is from John 19 and 28. And may I request Bob to read that for us, please.
After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, I thirst.
Jesus was very God of very God, but he was very man of very man. Here we see the intensity of his suffering. He proved during his earthly ministry that he was truly God. Through his power, through his wisdom, through his holiness, nature obeyed him, demons left, nature obeyed, diseases fled at his command, and storms still, demons scared away. Whatever he asked, at his command, things were happening. Dead raised to life, sick went home well. And here Jesus demonstrated he was not only truly God, but he was truly man. He hungered, Matthew tells us. Mark tells us he slept and he wept, John 11. Now he says, I thirst. He is thirsty. Whether we verbalize or acknowledge it, every person in the world is dissatisfied with one thing or the other. There is a thirst in every person's heart. There is hunger in every person's heart. And Christ alone can quench and satisfy our thirst. Without Christ, a person will forever cry, I am thirsty. Without Jesus, there is drought. It is arid. It is bone dry. It is parched. And it is barren. And it is desert. It is wilderness. Every person in the world, there is some sort of dissatisfaction. Absolutely there. There is not a one person in the world who would say, I'm absolutely satisfied with everything from the day I'm born to this day. Only Jesus can satisfy. He can quench our thirst. He can satisfy the thirst and hunger those who come to him. It is arid. It's bone dry without Jesus Christ. Acts 3:19 and 20 tells us, repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped away and the times of refreshing may come from the Lord. Times of refreshment comes from the Lord. Your life will remain arid, bone dry, barren, and desolate unless Jesus steps in. There is no refreshment in your life because scripture tells us refreshing days come when you repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Sixth saying is from John 19 and 30. And Mary, would you please read that for us? John chapter 19, verse 30.
When Jesus received the sour wine,
thank you so much. It's the word of victory, word of triumph, word of completion. It is finished. The Greek word is one word, tetelestai, which means it is finished. It is accomplished. Jesus didn't say, I am finished. He said, it is finished, because he's just about getting started. He is just getting started. The debt of sin is paid. God made him to be sin for us so that we may become the righteousness of God in him. 2 Corinthians chapter 5:21. Christianity is not about doing this or doing that. It is about believing in what has been done. It is believing in the finished work of Christ. That is Christianity. My guilt, my redemption, my condemnation, my penalty, my sins, my transgression, my iniquities, my wrongdoing, my malpractices, my bad habits, my nastiness, my horrid nature is laid upon Christ. And I trust in the finished work of Christ. The Hebrew word for atonement is covered, is covering. Christ covers our sin. He is covered. He's paid for them. It is clear. The debt is clear. Jesus' sacrifice done. All that is necessary for the sinner is to put faith, repent, and trust in him. You don't add anything to it. You don't take away anything from it. You believe the gospel and you will be saved. Last word is the seventh word. Is the from the Gospel of Luke chapter 23 and verse 46. And Val, could you please read that for us?
Then Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And having said this, he breathed his last.
Thank you so much. These are words of contentment, confidence, intimacy, surrender, and faith. The last words before Jesus died on the cross, he's back in communion with his Father. The broken communion is no longer there, but God, when God hid his holy face because of him carrying sins, but he is back in communion. He said, unto your hands, Father. Very important. Just a couple of minutes only, and we'll finish right here. Unto your hands, Father, I commit my spirit. I commend my spirit, some translations say. Some says, I entrust my spirit, bestow my spirit. He entrusted his spirit. What is so significant about that? For many hours, Jesus was in the hands of evil men. And look at the results. Now compare yourself when you're in the hands of man and when you're in the hands of God. I want you to make that stark, noticeable comparison and see what happened. When Jesus was for so many hours in the hands of evil men, his friends betrayed him. Judas. His friends denied him. His hands of his friends denied him. Emphatically, Peter. Not you, Peter. His friends, his very own friends, the soldier's hand beat Jesus and beat whips and scourged him. The hands of men placed thorns upon him and pressed it right down to his flesh. When he was at the hands of men, Jesus had been at the mercy of the hands of men who had no mercy. He was at the merciless hands of men, for as he had told them, it was their hour. It's the hour of the darkness. That's why Jesus went through what he went through. He then prayed the final prayer, what Valerie just read. Into your hands I commend my spirit. Things change when you put them in God's hand. Things change when you put things in God's hand. Someone said people who leave everything in God's hand will see God's hand in everything. If you leave everything in God's hand, you will see God's hand in everything. The Father's hand is the place of eternal security. None can pluck us from his hand. I think in the Old Testament, maybe it's Joel or one of the minor prophets, it says that not a grain will fall out of his hand. When he sieves through grains, not a single grain would fall out of the sieving or from his hand. He, from his threshing and all he's doing, and not a single grain would fall out of that. You are safe. God's hand is the safest place to be in. Psalm 145:6, it says, when you open your hand, you satisfy the hunger and thirst of every living thing. When God opens his hand, people find satisfaction. Is God's hand open on your family? Is God's hand is upon your life? Is God's hand is upon your children? Is God's hands upon your life? Is God's hands upon your church? Is God's hands upon your spouse? Is God's hands upon your partner? Is God's hands upon you? Because things change when they are in God's hand. Are you in the hands of God, my friend? The devil is out there to destroy you. The world and the flesh are against you. Come to Father, to Christ, who is your refuge and shelter. Let God's hand encircle you. God's hand is the safest place to be in. It's the safest place. It could be pandemic. It could be whatever damning, whatever is going on. You are safe in the hands of God. But you are unsafe even in no pandemic when you're not in the hands of God. Jesus said, into your hands, unto your hands, I commit my spirit. Men have done enough. They've tortured me enough. They've killed me enough. But I'm commit myself into your hands. You've been through a lot. You've suffered a lot. You've hurt a lot. You sinned a lot. Don't always feel pity for yourself of being through a lot. You've sinned a lot as well. Think about that too. Unto your hands I commit myself. Seven saying the dying Savior spoke. Three of them concerning men. We'll finish with this one. Three saying concerned men. I said it in the last year. And it's just that I'm going to repeat that, the last saying. Three saying concerned men, and three of his sayings were addressed to God. Which of the three utterances concerned men? Let's test you. I think it's nearly an hour since I've been talking. Which three concerned men?
Father, forgive them.
Thank you very much.
The thief on the cross.
There's one more.
The mother.
Yes. Correct. There's one more. So the thief on the cross, Father, forgive them. I would not say it's addressed to man, it's addressed to God. So I'm just talking the three utterances that addressed to men. Thief on the cross, he was addressing men. Mother. And there's one more, to the mass of spectators when he said he's thirsty. To the thirsty, when he said he's, to the spectators he said he's thirsty. Now these three utterances concern men. To the thief, to the mother, and to the spectators. Now other three utterances were addressed to God. Which one? One that Robert said, Father, forgive them. He addresses God. What's the other one?
I commit my spirit
into your hands.
The one I said, Father.
My God, why have you forsaken? Now these three addressed to God. There was one uttered in the hearing of God, men, angels, devil, demons, and he cried in triumph and absolute victory, and he said, it is finished. The job is done. The mission is accomplished. I've done it, what I was sent to do. Three to men, three to God, and one to everyone. To the demons and hell and grave and men and women and alike and whoever, living creature or dead or whatever it is, he said it is finished. The triumphant victory of Christ was there when he shouted with a loud cry and he said, it is finished. As if God looks down on his Father and he says, it is indeed, Son, it is finished. Let the men come to me through you now. Now we come to God through his son, Jesus Christ. For Jesus Christ came into the world to redeem the world from sin, to bring salvation, to remove transgression, to destroy Satan, to set up eternal kingdom of peace and glory for all those who love and believe in him. It is finished. What are people waiting for? What stops them from repenting? What stops them from coming to church? What stops them from reading the Bible? What stops them from praying? What stops them to putting money in the tithe box? What stops them from doing all that? What stops them from doing all that? Jesus said it is finished. Demons have heard that. Angels have heard that. Celestials have heard that. Terrestrials have heard that. Heavenly have heard that. Earthly know that. Everybody has heard Jesus shouting, "It is finished." May God help us and understand. It was intense, I understand that. But it is important that we understand, or try to understand, attempt to understand what Jesus really went through, or what Jesus endured for us. We'll close with prayer. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we worship you and we honor you. For when you shouted with a loud cry, "It is finished," it is finished indeed. My redemption is finished. My salvation is complete. Christ has accomplished that. Now I look up to the cross of Christ. Now I throw myself upon Christ and I am let in. I am allowed in. God lets me in because he sees the blood of Christ on my brow, on my forehead, and he sees he belongs to my son, Jesus Christ. Let him in. Do not stop him. Lord, we give you all the glory and honor. Thank you for being with us through all this hour and speaking to us, teaching us, admonishing us, instructing us, explaining to us, expounding us, explicating to us, and telling us what your son did. We just give you all the glory. We honor you. We love you. We worship you. We adore you. We magnify your name. We lift up your name. We fall upon you, Christ. We are right at your feet. We just even have the lick of the dust of your feet. That should be enough. The glimpse, beholding the glimpse of Christ would be satisfy me for eternity. Oh Lord, show yourself. Shine your face upon us. Forgive us our sins. Forgive us our transgressions. Be with us. Be merciful to us. Be compassionate to us. Thank you. Thank you for what you did on the cross. But you did not stay there. You rose again from the dead. You are victorious. You said it is finished, and you resurrected from the dead. And now you live. You're never going to die. You live forever because you're the Son of God, the Son of the living God. We worship you and we lift up your name. Thank you for being with us this morning. Be with us through the rest of the day. And when we come together again, let your blessings be upon us and teach us and instruct us the ways that we ought to go on. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray, and everyone say, Amen. Amen. Peace to the brothers and sisters, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Thank you very much. Thank you. God bless you. That's very generous of you.